Hello everyone. Before we get started, I have one little announcement. My dear friend Nicole Tascarella and I realized that our very amateur attempt at recording her music on a keyboard was not the quality that we were looking for, and so she has graciously agreed to re-record, making some adjustments to the audio and the equipment that we were using, and playing on piano. And we also had a guitarist that played along with her, who is my brother, Thomas Lickabaugh. And so I think what we're offering now is a much better source of music for you all to enjoy. And so you'll hear that in today's message. So please don't skip over the music. I'm pretty sure we've ironed out some of our issues with it. But with that being said, I would like to welcome you to worship. Whether it be morning or afternoon or evening that you're worshiping, I welcome you into this holy space. And no matter where you are mentally, physically, or spiritually, which may vary moment by moment, in the midst of what's going on, this moment and this place, this space, is for you. It's for you to find rest. It's for you to do that spiritual recharging that we talked about in the last service. And you can leave any reservations you have about your belief or your unbelief outside of here. It just doesn't matter, because this is a safe space. And though we're not gathered in a sanctuary, this is a place of sanctuary for you. And perhaps worshiping from home can teach us the purpose of the sanctuary in the church. That it's not just for who we would call God's people, but who God would call God's people. And I assure you, God would call people you would not call, and that I would not call. And many times I'm surprised that God even calls me. So let us remember, though none of us are worthy, we have all been called into this place of safety and into the sanctuary of God. We have been called into a place where no one and nothing, not even ourselves, can bring forth harm. That's what sanctuary is. It's a safe place. Now, this is challenging news to hear, being that it's not currently safe to gather in our buildings or in our physical sanctuaries. They are unsafe. And I heard of one story of a pastor who said God is bigger than the virus. And he held worship in a sanctuary, and then he ended up contracting and dying of the virus. And so to that I have to say, God is absolutely bigger than this virus. But that does not mean we can gather in our churches without consequences. God is bigger means that in this situation of despair and uncertainty and fear, we are not without God. Think of when the women went to the tomb and found it empty. An empty tomb did not mean their Lord had been taken away from them, just as empty sanctuaries are not indicative of us being taken away from our Lord. God has given us this amazing gift of curiosity that has fueled us across the ages in advancing technology and science in a way that we are saving lives by what we know about emerging diseases. We know things now that we haven't known in past pandemics that's saving lives. And so we're doing different things right now. We're doing things that we should have always been doing, but that we learned through hard lessons learned in past kind of pandemic situations. We learned about the importance of hygiene and washing our hands. And so maybe we're relearning that, or learning how to do it better. And we're also learning about the importance of social distancing, at least in this time, so that we can give scientists and healthcare workers the space to treat people in numbers that are manageable, and also to find treatments that will make it so we can again gather safely with one another. And so as we operate within this wisdom that God has given us in making us intelligent beings that are curious and seek out that wisdom and do that work of science that's so very important, we are also able to keep our lives connected to one another by way of technology. So while we're not immune to the troubles of this world, including contracting this virus, God is with us in our world wherever we are, guiding our wisdom, inspiring us in love, and giving us hope. This is the way of God's sanctuary. We find a safe space to hold on to hope, even in uncertain and unsafe times. And most importantly, the safe space of God's sanctuary is intended to lift us from feeling as if we do not belong. There is nothing that holds you back from the love of God. God says welcome to you, whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey. Let us now worship in that safe place that God creates with that love, that radically inclusive love. Let us now worship in that. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I heard it.
Show us your way, O God. Light our path, we pray. Today from afar we draw near to you in worship. Lord, ease our troubled hearts that we may celebrate today too. Let us not forget that this is the season of Easter. It is in your radically inclusive love that you include us in the inheritance of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And as an Easter people, we hold hope in the resurrection. And although we have not seen Christ with our own eyes, nor touched his pierced side with our own hands, we can rejoice in faith that Christ is with us. Christ is with us in the morning, in the evening, in our coming, in our going, in our staying, in our praying, in our weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. Amen. Psalm 16, 1 through 2 says, "Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you." Without our God, no matter how hard we try, we cannot be perfect or good. Thank God we are not expected to meet impossible standards, for our God is a loving and gracious God. Let us lay what burdens us at the foot of the cross as we join in a prayer of confession. Let us pray. God of mercy and forgiveness, I thank you for always being before me, with me, and within me, even when I continuously stray from you. I admit that I let my heart be misguided and troubled by this world. I put my faith in the wrong places and the wrong people. I project blame onto others instead of being accountable for my actions and inactions. I acknowledge that my own personal sin contributes to the pain and suffering of this world. I confess, O God, that my burdens trouble me and others. Help me, O Holy One, to pray in my inadequacies. Instruct my heart so that I may walk in your ways and not my own. Christ, I need you. I am grateful for you. I lay my burdens at your feet, not so that I may walk away without responsibility, but so that I may stand up in your strength. Strengthen me, O Christ, that in your forgiveness that I may also forgive, in your love that I may also love, and in your peace that I may also be one of peace. Amen. When Jesus died on the cross and rose again, he conquered the death that was to be the consequence of our sins, for he was without sin. In conquering sin and death on our behalf, we receive a new inheritance that is imperishable and unfading. What we inherit is being reserved for us in the perfection of heaven, but offered to us now in the brokenness of our world. God chooses us, and in God's choosing has forgiven us for falling away from all that is perfect and good. You are so deeply loved by God that God did not want you to go your entire life without knowing this. And God did not want to go all of eternity without you. So in this forgiveness, in this love, and in this knowing, go forth an abundant blessing. Go forth living this life and every moment after in the amazing love of God. Spread this love far and wide, friends. Amen.
Hi everyone, I hope you're doing well. I've been doing a lot of listening this week as I've been reading and thinking about scripture. One good thing that's come out of what's happening right now is a lot of my friends from seminary and from other churches have been sharing uplifting messages online, and so I've never seen so much content available every week, especially from people who are close to me. So it's been really nice. It's been really nice to be able to listen to other people and how they're thinking about God in the week. And so I want to give you something to think about. I have this book. It's called Zen Shorts. And I'm not going to read the book to you, but it is a really good book. I recommend, if you can, find it online, order it, or see if your library has it in a digital kind of format or something like that. But it's called Zen Shorts because Zen means meditation, to think deeply about something, to be reflective, to be thoughtful. And shorts, not only because this cute, adorable little panda is wearing shorts, but because there's three short things to think about and meditate on in here. The panda meets three kids, and then the panda tells each kid one story that to think about. And so I think this is a good book to share because there's one story in here that made me think of something that happened to me this week that I would like to share with you. So I will turn to that story real quick and I'll show you. I'm not going to read it word for word, but I'll give you the rundown of what happens in this story. So there's the picture, and the panda is telling a story about what happened to his uncle. His uncle had a robber break into his home. Now, his uncle's a bear, and the robber is a raccoon. And what happened when he caught him was he said, "Welcome, welcome. How nice of you to visit," which is a really funny way to greet a robber. Do you think that if somebody broke into your home, that your mom and dad would run up to them and say, "Oh, how nice of you to pay us a visit"? I don't think that would be our first reaction. And there's nothing wrong with not reacting that way, because that would be really scary. So I don't think what this story is trying to teach us is to be foolish. Because it would be kind of foolish to not be afraid. It would be kind of foolish to not call 911 or do whatever you can to be safe. But I think this story is trying to teach something different. So what his uncle ends up doing is giving the robber away what little things he actually does have to offer, which is a very tattered old robe. And then he feels bad that he couldn't offer better. And so this reminds me of a story in our Bible that I think helps us to kind of meditate more on what the lesson of that story is. And so if you turn to Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew in the New Testament, and you go to chapter 5, and then you look at the smaller numbers and you go the whole way to number 38, starting with verse 38. It says this. Jesus says, and he's talking to a group of people, "You have heard it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you." So that's a really challenging scripture, because there are people in this world that do things that are harmful And we do have to be wise and cautious. And of course, you should always tell an adult if somebody's being cruel to you or somebody's taken something from you. But I think what the moral of the story here is to dig deeper than what our first reaction is about people. So, to help you process this text, let me tell you something that happened to me this week. This week, I was making masks to wear for people who are on the front lines of the pandemic. So healthcare workers and people who are working in grocery stores and things like that. And my oldest daughter, Ella, was helping me and she was cutting out the fabric. And so I took a picture and I shared it with her teacher, and her teacher shared it with the classroom. Well, one of the moms sent me an email, and I don't know this mom, but she sent me an email and she said, can I have a mask? Now, I'm making these masks for people who are working in healthcare or grocery stores, people who are coming in contact with a lot of other people every day and they need protection, and maybe they don't have the protection that they need in their jobs. And so any mask I give to anyone else means that that's one less mask that I can give to a worker that really needs it, even though we all should wear them and we all need them to keep each other safe. So I thought about this request, and before I could even respond to her, she sent me another message and she said, I've been so afraid. You know, can you actually give me enough for, you know, me and my husband and my two children? So she wanted 4 masks. And at first I was kind of angry because I thought, well, this is really greedy. But then I thought, well, I understand being afraid. And I don't blame her for wanting to find a way to protect herself and her family and her children especially. And she saw an opportunity to ask somebody for help. And so I decided that I would make some masks especially for her and her children. And so I made some child-sized ones, and I made one for her and her husband. And I agreed to meet with her to give them to her at a safe distance. I met with her at a park, and I put them somewhere, and I said, they're over there. But I sat in my car and waited and watched to make sure nobody else, you know, grabbed them. Because she lived in an apartment building, so I couldn't, like, drop them off on her porch or anything. And somebody had said to me, what if she's just taking your free masks and she's selling them and using the money for something she shouldn't be using the money for? And that did kind of worry me. I thought, what if she is trying to take advantage of me? You know, should I help her? I mean, isn't it kind of rude of her to even ask? I told her these are for essential workers and she's not an essential worker. But I decided, and I remembered the scripture that Jesus shares, and I decided, I'm not just going to give her one mask, I'm going to give her 4. I'm going to give enough for her whole family. And, you know, she offered to pay me too, and, you know, I didn't take payment from her for all the masks, so, it was a hard decision, and I still don't know if I made the right decision. I don't know if she's really going to use them. I don't know if she's going to resell them for some astronomical amount of money and then use that money for something she shouldn't be. But what Jesus is telling us is when, even if we think people might be doing something wrong, we should always try to do the best thing that we can do in the moment. And so, we have to be careful with this scripture, because there are times when we try to do our best and it's not a good thing. And I'll just give you a quick example. My daughter Ella had a child last year who was bullying her. every single day in school. He was so mean and so cruel, and we tried to teach her the right way to be. We tried to teach her, you know, some kids have a really difficult life at home where their parents are not very good to them, not very nice to them, and so they don't know how to treat people in a way that's kind and nice because they don't see that at home. Or some kids have some sort of mental illness that keeps them from behaving the way other kids behave. They just can't control themselves in a way that is appropriate. And so we tried to explain these things to Ella, and we also tried to teach her, like, why don't you try to be his friend? Why don't you try to be nice to him? You know, say hi to him. If it looks like he doesn't have anybody to play with at recess, offer to let him play with you and your friends and that kind of thing. And that really didn't work. That made it worse. And so we talked to the teacher and we had them separated. And that was a really hard thing to do because at first she was really trying to do the right thing. She was trying to be a friend, she was trying to be kind, she was trying to ignore him, she was trying to be patient, all of these good things. And all you can do is try to do the best you can. And if the best you can doesn't work, then you just have to leave it up to God to take care of it. And so Ella had to be separated from that student. And then we talked to the principal about him not being in the same class with her the next year. And so he wasn't in the same class with her this year, which has been really good for her. And now he doesn't even go to the school anymore, for whatever reason. I don't really know. I think the kid needed a lot more help than what the school could give him. But what's important is that Ella did the best she could as a human being to be kind to somebody else. Maybe someday he'll remember that. Maybe not. It doesn't matter. If more of us were like that, maybe it would make a difference in the lives of these types of people. Maybe it wouldn't. But it can make a difference for you. Because you train yourself to be the kind of person that is trying to do what is good. You're trying to live the way Christ wants us to live. And I think this bear in our story giving the robber the best he could give, maybe that helped the robber realize, this is not the best I can do with my life. What's the best I could give? If this person was willing, or this bear was willing to give me the best what he had and it wasn't even that great, I can do a lot better with my life than robbing houses. You don't know, maybe the raccoon became a better person because of the bear. And maybe the bear is a better person for practicing that care of other people, even when other people don't seem like they care, if that makes sense. So, I don't know. It's a lot to think about, and so that's what the word Zen means. Something deep to think about. What is the right answer in this story? There's things for the bear to practice and learn, and there's a lot of things for that raccoon to practice and learn. And I think what Jesus teaches us is that God judges people for the choices that they make, that we do have to face the consequences of the things that we do. But we should just try to do our very best to be a kind person, to be a giving person, because in the end, things don't matter. People matter. So that's the most important thing I think can come from the story in the Zen Shorts book or the story that Jesus is trying to teach. Things do not matter. Things can be replaced. people matter. And so it's important to try to take care of other people. But it's also important to take care of yourself. So if you're in a situation like Ella, where she tried to show that person that they mattered, she tried to be a friend, she tried to be kind, but it didn't work. It wasn't healthy for her to continue to try that. That ended up hurting her. It ended up being really stressful for her and burdensome for her, and a lot for her to try to handle. And so the best thing for her was to just for there to be distancing, and definitely for me and her teacher to work something out. So make sure you're taking good care of yourself. If you're trying to take, you know, this route of being good to others, even in the face of them not being so good to you. And in this time we have at home, be especially good to your parents and your siblings. You know, do some extra chores. Go the extra mile. You know, be thoughtful. Think about what you can do to make someone's day in your home, or even outside of your home. You know, call somebody on the phone that you know doesn't have anybody that lives with them, and ask them how they're doing, and just listen, and, you know, ask them, you know, about, you know, how their day is going, or to tell you a story about when they were younger, or whatever it may be. Reach out to somebody, go that extra mile, be thoughtful, and that's all I got for today. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we are so grateful for the stories that you give to us in our lives, in books, in scripture, that invite us to stop and think. Stories that tell us that our first reaction to things might not be the best reaction. That maybe we have to think about things in a different kind of way. Lord, thank you for these reminders to be thoughtful, to be caring of other people. Thank you for the reminder that it's not things that matter, it's people that matter. Lord, teach us to love others as you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So for our prayer time today, I'm doing something a little different. I have these three questions that are really great questions to use for reflection, so that you can practice healthy self-care and they can guide you in your prayer. And I've included some adaptations below that are important for this time of lockdown. So I encourage you to take these questions and do a little self-assessment at the end of the day. Or if you're like me, by the end of the day, I'm too tired to do this kind of deep thinking. If I start thinking this deeply late at night, I'll end up, my brain just starts racing and I can't go to sleep. So I just do this kind of thing in the morning with some tea and my Bible, and I just sit down and I think of these three questions and I say a little prayer. So even if it's going to be a busy day ahead of me, even if I have a lot to do on my plate, this is something that you can do in like 5 minutes. And it's a really important practice, because if you do it daily, or at least frequently, weekly, as often as you can remember it, it trains your heart and your mind and your spirit. It trains you to in the first question to take whatever darkness there is and pull it out into the light. Because when you pull things out in the light, you can see them for what they are, you can get some power over them, you can keep them from manifesting into something darker. So that's what the first question is about. What am I grieving today? Just name that. Bring that out into light. Or what has, excuse me, what has COVID-19 taken away from me today? Just name it. Be honest. Bring that out into the light. Because when you bring it into the light, maybe you don't have an answer for how to deal with it, but offer that up to God in prayer. Our second question, what am I grateful for today, or what can COVID-19 not touch today, is this practice of finding finding joy or finding blessing in each day. Finding something tangible that you can hold on to and that can get you through this moment into the next moment. What can you be grateful for today? No matter how hard your life is, you can find something to be grateful for. And if that's a hard practice for you, then doing this frequently will teach you to find something to be grateful for. It could be something as small as, I'm grateful for hearing the sound of birds outside my window today. It's a really, really important practice to find that grateful thing, to find that thing that COVID-19 cannot touch, or that whatever's troubling you cannot touch. The next one, what is the unexpected gift for today? So what does COVID-19 give me today? That's a really interesting take. What is something that you have? What is a gift that you have today because of COVID-19? Now that would be unexpected, wouldn't it? And this practice of finding that unexpected gift helps us to practice living in hope that we'll find something gifted and unexpected tomorrow too. So we're going to take this time of prayer with one another. We're going to reflect on these questions to ourselves. So feel free to pause for more time. I'm not going to take a lot of time on this slide to pause. I can't gauge how much time you need. But what's wonderful about worshiping from home is that you can pause this slide as long as you need to and reflect upon these things. And then on the next slide, we'll join together in the Lord's Prayer. So let us enter into this space of prayer and contemplation. The Lord be with you. Let us reflect upon these three questions today before we join in the Lord's Prayer. What am I grieving today? What does COVID-19 take away from me today? What am I grateful for today? What can COVID-19 not touch today? What is the unexpected gift today? What does COVID-19 give me today? Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi everyone, for today's message I wanted to be a little bit more casual, so I don't have my collar on. It's just me and you, person to person, for this message today. I want to share some things that I was reflecting on this week, so this isn't a super structured message, but a message nonetheless. So let's get started on let's get started by reading our scripture for today. So we're going to start at John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Hear now the word of God. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I really appreciate how the Gospel of John kind of, it goes from telling this story in the Gospel, and then it looks right at you almost and says, this is written for you. This is written so that you believe. Not everything that happened is written here, but what is needed for you to believe in the Messiah is here for you. This is what you need to know so that you can have belief without having to touch those wounds of Jesus. So I really appreciate that. But I have to admit, this week, when I should have been meditating in this text because it was for my sermon, I was reading the Bible before bed on Monday night, and I got stuck in the book of Mark at the ending. Not at the very, very ending, but and chapter 16, verses 8. This is whenever the women went to the tomb and it was empty. And it says here, "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." Now, this verse is where the book of Mark, where the text ends. And some scholars believe that it's just because the rest of the text is missing. And others believe that Mark did this intentionally, maybe to be dramatic, because clearly the good news of Christ being risen has been told and is out there, but we know it because 2,000 years later we're still talking about it. But Mark is being really dramatic in this moment. And so the text that we read after that verse has been added from other sources to kind of complete the gospel. Some people have edited this work afterwards to put it in the canon, and they've added these other versions to end on Mark. And so this week I found myself stuck in that moment with these women who were just stuck in terror. They fled from the empty tomb and they said nothing, which fascinated me and struck me in a way that just hasn't struck me before. And I think the reason I felt that way is because I have felt really stuck this week. Just very kind of lost in my own ways, emotionally and mentally and spiritually and physically this week. I've had some low points. And so I was reflecting a lot, and I spoke with my pastor about the scripture too. Have you ever felt stuck? Especially during this time. I'm sure you have. I'm sure you've had your days where you just felt so stuck. Even if it was just like you feel stuck in the house and you're going a little stir crazy, which is certainly part of what I'm feeling. But I find it fascinating about these women just being struck with fear, rendered speechless. And if they truly didn't say anything, could you really blame them? Now, we know that's not true because of other gospel accounts, but even if we didn't have those accounts, could you blame them? Women of their time were of very low status. There were some male slaves that had higher status than them that could inherit land and property in ways that they couldn't. So they were very low in social status. And to see this miraculous thing of God had to be very intimidating, because how can you say the right thing about God, the one of the highest status, to anyone else, if you're someone who is among the lowest? And then you have to tell these other people in your society that are a higher status this thing you saw. How do you say it correctly? It's really important to say the right things about God. So how do you make sure you say the right thing about God? And then it could be dangerous for their lives to say these things to people in their society. They just killed Jesus. So there was this deeper cost of saying the wrong thing about God, and then there was this very immediate cost of saying the wrong thing that could get them persecuted. Maybe that isn't what rendered them speechless, but it could have been just pure fear too. They just didn't have any words to say. They hadn't processed it. It's really hard to process things when you're frozen in fear. I feel like I've been slow to process things in this pandemic, which I imagine is some form of self-preservation, something that my brain is doing to care for itself, to just process things a little bit slower, maybe so I'm not overthinking things, maybe so I can process it in waves. I'm not really sure. In the book of Mark, it could have been a moment of self-preservation. They were slow to process what happened, but even after that, can you just imagine the levity of sharing something as perfect, as important, and as important as the resurrection? And how do you get that news out the right way? And have you ever been frustrated with not being able to make things right or perfect or better? I think sometimes we get obsessed with being right or trying to be perfect. And what I've found is I am my worst when I am trying to be perfect. I am the worst mom when I try to compete with the perfect image of a mom. Or even when I try to compete with myself. My kids really don't need that. They need me to be a human being that makes mistakes and is messy and reassures them that it's okay to not be perfect as a mom or as a person. People really need to see that. And I think as Christians, sometimes we mess that up. Sometimes we act like as Christians, we need to be perfect. We have to have the perfect morals and the perfect lifestyle and the perfect image and the perfect clothing and the outward appearance. Meanwhile, inside, that's not true. Or in our homes, that's not true. We can't be perfect. That's why we know we need Jesus. So why are we living this untruth to other people as Christians? We're hurting people. We're hurting ourselves and we're hurting people by putting forth this false image of perfection. Just like that doesn't help my kids to think that I'm a perfect person or a perfect mom. They need to see me as a human. They need to see my humanity. As Christians, that's true too. And so for my kids, as much as I love them, I'm my worst when I try to be perfect because I end up burning myself out. I end up portraying this wrong image towards them of this impossible standard. And many of the images we see out there in the world of perfection we envision for ourselves as moms or Christians, as dads, grandpas, grandmas, work in the workplace, whatever it is, physical beauty, they have been edited and fabricated for our consumption, but they're not reality. And the most important thing for us to do is to learn how to love ourselves for who we are in the moment and try to grow as a person and to love the people around us the best we can in the moment and try to grow that love. And we learn how to grow our love of self and of God and of each other in our faith. And that's more important than having these perfect images, these unattainable things. And so I imagine that's part of this element that could have been happening with the women, why they were just rendered speechless. And I also think that the story that we see in today's scripture, this healthy skepticism of Thomas, he's sometimes called Thomas the Doubter, but I think this is actually good. It's a good thing. It can be a good thing. He says, I need to touch Jesus's wounds. This is a person who I think has grown wise to the tricks of humanity. And so he has his head and his heart got guarded. And I wish people would practice some of that guarding themselves. And what I mean by that is don't believe everything you read online or see on your favorite news channel. Don't share everything that you agree with on Facebook, because it might not be true or it might not be the full truth. And if you don't know how to do fact checking with reliable scientific sources, then you're going to end up spreading harmful half-truths or complete untruths. And it's just better to not say anything at all. So Thomas is like, look, I don't want to be hurt, and I don't want to hurt others if this is an untruth. I won't take that risk. It's too important. I think it's a really faithful thing to do. And so I'm grateful for Thomas, because I have to believe in Christ without touching his pierced sides and without touching his hands. But I have this first person information that's reassuring me that somebody else did it. Because I feel like I would want to do it. And so I'm glad there's somebody like Thomas there, who's as imperfect and as slow to process things as I am. And if you're an imperfect, slow person, slow processing person like me, or the women at the tomb, or Thomas, it's okay. Because that's not going to keep God away. My pastor had a message this week about Jesus coming through our locked doors. And if we look at the scripture passage, I have underlined those parts in this text on our slide. And even if no one said a word about the resurrection, even if the Gospel of Mark was the only account we had, Christ was coming anyways. Even if we are a complete wreck inside our homes, Christ comes knocking. Not even knocking. Christ just comes inside. And he doesn't care about the dirty dishes in the sink. There's no time to clean up before Jesus gets in. Jesus doesn't care about your laundry that's piled up or that you're still in your pajama pants. He's not going to judge you for not wearing pants during your Zoom call with your coworkers or for having cereal for dinner. Christ comes with good news, and he has given everything for you so that you can have peace, not only in life after death, but right now in this moment. So there is comfort in knowing that there is nothing that keeps God out or away from us. There's no fear. There's no locks. There's not a bit of doubt or imperfections or even us trying to hide ourselves away that can keep Jesus out. God seeks us. God finds us. And God speaks a living word upon us, saying, "Peace be with you." And it's said 3 times in the scripture text. I have it in bold for you. 3 times, "Peace be with you." Say that to yourself every day 3 times. See if it doesn't give you some peace. "Peace be with you," Jesus says. There is nothing that can keep you stuck or silent or afraid. When you have this freeing and spoken and healing peace of Christ that is always seeking you and always with you. Amen.